Greetings from Metawani, Bruno here with the one and only Pontus Norgren of Hammerfall. How are you doing, Pontus?
I'm doing great, man. Thank you.
All right. So you guys are going to unleash a new album in November, Built to Last. How pumped is the band with your first upcoming release with Napalm Records?
Actually, the deal from Nuclear Blast was done, so to speak, and we really needed to, you know, improve ourselves and, you know, take Hammerfall to the next level.
Sure, yeah.
And, of course, you know, when the deal was over in Nuclear Blast, we asked them maybe to renew the deal, and at the time we were shopping and asking others, and Napalm came up, and I think, you know, what the business plan and promotion plan and everything was, you know, felt totally right for us at the moment. So, and a long relation, you know, how a long relationship can be, you have to, you know, renew yourself in a long relationship also. So.
Sure, that's great to hear. Mm-hmm. So, the band has a new lyric video for the song Sacred Vow, which has that particular Hammerfall vibe all over, from the epic choruses to that fist up high atmosphere, you know. Also the lyrics have some references about early Hammerfall tunes like Heeding the Call and Steel Meets Steel. How's been the reception of the song so far by the fans and the media?
I have to say I'm more or less blown away, because everyone, we never released like a lyric video before, and when Napalm said that this is how we want to do it, because you do that nowadays, and we're like, okay, so the Sacred Vow came up as that song, and, you know, of course, we just came out of the production, so all the songs, you know, when we're recording an album, it's, you duplicate everything along the way, so you don't get the full picture of the album. But when we released it and getting the response from the audience that, you know, this is so much Hammerfall, this is exactly, and it's fresh and, you know, energetic and everything, it was like, wow, you know, that warms your heart a lot.
Oh, that's great. I love this song also. So I think you guys are definitely on the right track to the new album, and actually I've been listening to Built to Last for the past 2 days or so, and I've noticed that you guys are relying again on the more classic Hammerfall sound, as with the Sacred Vow, with a lot of O's and the chords and epic anthems. The song Bring It, for example, the first song in the album, reminded me a bit of what Grave Digger is used to do, meaning the guitar lines. And the song Hammer High has that cool warlord vibe. Is this something that you guys think of before writing the songs, or is just something that comes out naturally because of your influence by traditional metal?
The whole writing session or the writing period with Hammerfall is like, we plan the record and everything. It's not like we write 25 songs and then choose 10 or 11 songs for an album. We start to write, and on this album, it's been more or less Joacim and Oskar writing the songs. Unfortunately, my father passed away just during the writing period, and so I couldn't be a part of it as I was on the Revolution album. But the fun thing is, like, when nowadays with technology, you know, you send MP3s with ideas and stuff, and ideas started to come from Oskar, and it came to me, you know, and I was like, wow, cool, and it felt right. And then you follow the whole writing session period, and it's like, it just, everything falls in place. And it's not, like I said, it's not 25 songs that choose 10 or 11. The songs just develop along the way, and it comes out. And when we go into the studio, the melodies are there, and we have more or less everything arranged, but then we start to do the guitar lines, the guitar melodies and everything, and work around that in the actual production recording process, because then we can, you know, get the feeling from the vocals, or get the feeling from the rhythm guitars and everything. So it's a great process, and we have so much fun because we found the recipe. Or if we go back, we started, you know, to record stuff ourselves on the Infected album, and then of course we had a long break, and during that break we decided to what's good and what's bad. We took away all the bad stuff, we kept the good stuff, and we invited Fredrik Norström again on the Revolution album, and we kept that concept to this album, because we felt with the success of Revolution, it was like, it felt like, you know, the first album you ever recorded again, and we all wanted to get that feeling again, you know, that we feel young at heart and energetic and, you know, powerful, and not like we're in the mid-40s, and, you know, we're so lucky that we found that spark again, that it feels like,
It does sound, it does sound a lot energetic and refreshing, I would say that the best word to describe
That's when we, you know, we want to, how we want to perform. We want to have that feeling when we record and perform. And I think that's important, and I hope it's contagious to the fans. And I have said during the Revolution tour, you know, every day I saw in the eyes of the audience, you know, they were so happy.
Yeah.
And that makes me happy, because then I could deliver the feeling I had during the recording.
Yeah, that's great to hear. Speaking of the songwriting process of this new album, Built to Last, you already mentioned this, but you had a prominent role in Revolution, writing the lyrics and music for the songs Bushido, Tainted Metal, and Wildfire, and which are very different from each other in the arrangements and such. You had a less prominent role with Built to Last because of the passing away of your father, unfortunately. But what was your participation this time in the music content to Built to Last? Just recorded the guitar lines or did something?
The good thing is, you know, because I'm so much in, you know, I work as a producer, I work as a sound engineer. On the side, you know, I did other productions and stuff. And the thing is, what I contributed into this one was, you know, being a downfall for Oskar also, you know. Because Oskar normally, he starts the painting when it comes to writing. And then I do the, you know, final touch with all the small guitar things that comes up and melodies. Because normally he doesn't write that many melodies. He empties himself, you know, with just the song, the ideas, everything. So he's sort of the ground of coming up with the riffs and everything. And then Joacim writes the melodies and, you know, lyrics. And then it's like...
Yeah, you're also a sound engineer, right?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I work a lot of... The last couple of years, I've produced a lot of Swedish stuff. I also toured a lot with King Diamond and done the front of house sound for him.
Yeah. You also worked with Vicious Rumors on the live album, right?
Oh,
that's awesome. So you've been with Hammerfall since 2008, right? And have recorded like 4 albums so far, including Built to Last. Can you tell me about how's the experience been in these years, being part of one of the biggest heavy metal bands of today? Can you tell me a little about that?
I have to say, when I came into the band, just the tour before, I supported Hammerfall in my old band, the Poodles.
Yeah.
And we started to get along very well, me, Joachim, and the rest. I mean, I've known Anders Johansson for ages, you know, way back since late 80s, and the thing is, you know, I was, you know, getting in, and we were talking, and we had the same ideas, we were talking about the same things, and, you know, when they asked me to come in, when Stefan left for being a jet pilot, his second rock and roll ring, I was like, you know, okay, wow, this is a little bit, you know, bigger.
Yeah.
it's going to be a lot more touring and everything. And but still, it's, you know, us five guys, when we work together, I never walk around at home thinking, oh, fuck, I'm going to do an amazing tour with HAMMERFALL in the U.S., and we're going to do all the festivals, and we're going to stand in front of 85,000 people. It's more or less like, okay, now I have to go up and perform, try to, you know, get my feeling out to the audience. And that, of course, I'm fortunate to be able to do this at my age, you know. We're in the mid-40s, all of us, and we can still rock.
Yeah.
I love every minute of it. It's a lot of work, but I love every minute of it.
That's awesome. You replaced Stefan Elmgren, and it's not an easy task because he was one of the most important members of HAMMERFALL, especially since he was a fan favorite, and you've been doing a great job since day one. Can you tell me more about the adaptation process of replacing Stefan and making friends with you already told us it was easy to make friends with Joacim, Oskar and Anders and such. And how was the reception of the fans in your first live performances with the band?
I have to say they took me in very fast. Of course, you know, social media and stuff, some people complained because they missed Stefan, and yeah. I can understand that, but his choice in life, he was with HAMMERFALL for 10 years, and he, you know, did his, he managed to be in his rock and roll dream for 10 years, and his second rock and roll dream was to be a pilot, and he wasn't that typical rock and roll guy. On the tour we did together when I was playing the Poodles, he was studying to be a pilot every day. So that was his second rock and roll dream. And, you know, if the audience didn't understand that, that he went on to another rock and roll dream, so to speak. And that's why, you know, some people were quite nasty on the internet and stuff. But I don't care, of course.
Uh-huh.
You know, sure. He had an important role in HAMMERFALL, but, you know, I'm a long-term friend with Stefan since, you know, the mid-90s. I know him very, very well, and I love him as a guitar player and as a friend. And actually, he joined us when Frederick has to be home with his kids on the last tour on the Revolution tour. So Stefan played bass, and we were switching in the middle of the set. So that was, you know, it's the fans. You know, now I'm part of HAMMERFALL, and I'm still the new guy. but anyway, it's like I understand the fans, because you go in there and you've had, for example, Stefan as an idol for 10 years, and then he disappears, and I come in and take his place, and another person comes in and takes his place. Of course, some people get, you know, not angry, but, you know, it's like disappointing a little bit. But I think that's a part of everyone. Look at Axl Rose in AC/DC.
Yeah.
People hated it, but then he went up on stage and did a good job. And he wasn't there to take over. He was there to help out.
Yeah.
And the thing is, I got, you know, I got the axe, sort of, from Stefan, because he said, I'm done with this. Please take this for the next 10 years. Or
take the torch.
Love to do it. And I think the fans like it nowadays. So,
I want to talk a little bit about the album Infected. In that album, the band tried a different approach in a lot of aspects.
Yeah.
From the darker and more dense sound of the sound to the lack of vector in the album cover, but came back to the traditional approach with Revolution. What was the main intention with Infected, and in your opinion, what did and didn't work in the album?
I have to say, you know, that's I still have a feeling that Infected is one, you know, one of my favorite albums when it comes to the songs, and when it comes to stuff. But then we come back to what I was talking about earlier, that at the period, at that time frame in HAMMERFALL's history, we had some bad things going on. We went through two different management.
No.
It was that we were you know, seekers. We were searching for something that was in the band already, but we couldn't find for ourselves. And that made a big impression of the whole album. Mm-hmm. And if you listen to the album and listen to the songs, of course, it's a little bit darker and stuff. And I think that, you know, when you work with people that don't think the same, and we had two management that sort of, it was contagious. You know, it was bad karma coming from not personally, you know, pointing out both the management, but
wow,
the whole scenario just became ugly, sort of, and that infected the band. So I think that actually the title is very, very perfect, because something happened in there. It was something was contagious, and we caught the disease that we didn't know we caught, and that's why we decided after infection to take a break.
Uh-huh.
And clean out all the bad stuff. And when we decided to take a break, we said we're not going to do anything related to HAMMERFALL for a year. And everyone went their own way. Oskar
wow.
wrote the book, Joacim did musicals, I went out on tour with other bands doing sound, and Frederick, he was working on his own with his own stuff and his other band. And after about a year, we started to talk, and the spark came back. And then we cleaned away all the bad stuff and just kept the good ones. And the good ones was that when we did it together the way we wanted it, then we got the spark, and that was shining through so much on the Revolution album.
Yeah, yeah. Which was...
I think the fans... And they're infected. Something was infected, you know. We don't know what it was. Something was wrong, and we needed a break to clean that out. And we cleaned it out, and we came back stronger than ever. And the Revolution was, you know, one of the most successful albums we ever released.
Yeah. So basically, infected was a lot personal for you guys in that aspect
yeah.
of...
But we didn't know it. We didn't know it. We just felt that something was wrong.
That feeling.
And the break was so needed. We didn't know if we would come back. But after like 8-9 months, we started to talk, and everyone, what we really wanted was to do another album, and that was the result of this Revolution.
Yeah, that's awesome. Were you guys thinking about going back to the more traditional sound when you guys reunited, made in the early works? Or did you kind of turn back to that idea after fan requests and such? Or
no,
the idea was already there?
It just came natural. When the spark came back, the more up-tempo songs came back, the
mm-hmm.
happy vibe with the deliverance of, you know, just individual performance from drums to bass to guitars, everything, it just came natural. That album just, you know, sort of wrote itself. And when we brought back Frederick also, Nordstrom as a producer, you know, we were talking the same language, and because I'm orientated in production and stuff like that, we started,
mm-hmm.
started to talk, and I thought that it should be simple, and should just catch the energy in the sounds and everything, and just, yeah, and don't complicate, don't add stuff that we don't need, don't, you know, we just keep it clean and let the songs do the talking, and I think we managed to do that with the Revolution, and now we're going to last. We took it to the next step and kept that energy, and went in some parts of the album, you know, we didn't know that we could do. So that's amazing.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's amazing to have it back when we're
yeah.
in the mid-40s. I have to say, it's like feeling like a teenager again, and like, wow, this art, and you want to just go out on the road and, you know, rock everywhere.
Yeah, and it's the best way to get it back, right? Coming off naturally from the inside and such. Yeah, that's awesome. So you guys have a tour coming up in 2017 entitled Built to Tour, right? With dates across Europe. So can you tell us about what to expect from the upcoming shows and if you guys have plans on making a worldwide tour of the Europe dates?
Yes, it's at the moment it's not official, but the plan, what we're planning is starting with the European tour in January and February, and then we go more or less straight to South America, and after that the UK, then we come back home, and then we go over to the US, and we come back in mid-May, and then we hit the festival summer in Europe, of course.
Yeah.
And then it's going to go on until 2018.
Wow, it's going to be a busy year then.
It's going to be a very busy year.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that because I'm based in Brazil. I'm a correspondent for Metal Wani, but I live in Brazil, and I was going to ask you guys if you were coming to Brazil. So I guess that's a positive then. You guys are coming to South America.
We will come to Brazil.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So to conclude our interview, can you describe the sound of Built to Last in just one sentence? Keeping it simple.
It's going to kick you in the face.
Wow. That's great. I actually, I had the privilege to hear the album, and I agree 100% with you. The magic is there.
That's the feeling I have when I listen to it. When I just press play, and it's like, fuck yeah.
Yeah, I had the same reaction. So I want to thank you again for taking the time to speak with us. And
my pleasure.
Okay, thank you.